For the past 2 weeks now, we have been talking about the basic principles in the kingdom of God, of Christianity. 2 weeks ago, we talked about the righteousness of God. That God has made us righteous. You are who you are because of what Jesus has made us to be. He became sin, so that we may be righteous. And last week we talked about justification. That you have been justified through the blood of Jesus Christ. That because you have been justified, made righteous, God now has qualified us to be partakers of his blessing. To be partakers of his divine nature. And to be partakers of his inheritance. Amen?
Amen?
I'm teaching this subject so that we can be rooted and be founded in the things of God. That we may not be moved by the tricks of the enemies to condemn, to make us feel unworthy. But I've been teaching this so that you can boldly and confidently go to your Heavenly Father who loves you. Regardless of your performance, who loves you so much that he sacrificed his only son for you. So having established that you are righteous, because righteousness is a gift given to us by our Father through the sacrifice of his son, Jesus Christ, and because of that, has justified us and then qualified us to be partakers of the inheritance. Today I want to talk about sanctification. Sanctification is one of the subjects many believers, many of us want to hear about. But if they can understand that word sanctification and God's word concerning sanctification, they will love to hear it because they will find out it is by the grace of God that he's saying it is his will for us to live in sanctification. Amen? Turn your Bible with me to the book of 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. If you are there, please say amen with me. 1 Thessalonians is before Timothy.
After Colossians.
1 Thessalonians chapter 5. Amen. Let us read from verse 23. No, I'm going to start from verse 22. 22 says, abstain from all appearance of evil. And 23 says, and the very God of peace sanctify you wholly. And I pray that your whole spirit and soul and body be preserved blameless unto the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. This is where we get the revelation that we are three parts to him. He says, the God of peace sanctify her wholly, that our spirit, soul, and body, three parts to him, be preserved blameless unto the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. In our spirit, we have already been made holy, we have already been made righteous. And we already been justified. Through our spirit, we can talk to God anytime. Because spirit speaks to spirit. God is a spirit. And those that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. So anytime you want to go to God, God is not looking at your outward appearance to hear your prayer. Or he's not looking at your performance or your good works to hear your prayer. He sees your spirit. He looks at you and he sees that you are holy and you are righteous through the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, and your profession of faith in believing in Jesus Christ, because of that, He justifies you and He hears all your prayers. Because you are the inward man. The Bible says the inward man of the heart, the man in inside. That is the real you. The real you has been sanctified, made holy, made righteous, justified. And that is the only one that is talking to God. That is why we have to get into the spirit when we are praying. Sometimes we close our eyes so that we can tune out all the things of distraction, so that we can get into the spirit to be able to pray to God, so that we can express and give Him all the desire of our hearts. So, sanctification. What is sanctification? Sanctification means to separate. It means to set apart. See, in order for God to deal with mankind, He has to separate us and set us apart. Your spirit has been made holy, righteous, and is set apart. But sanctification, there are two aspects of sanctification. There are two aspects of sanctification described in the New Testament. Number one, the first one is positional sanctification. Positional sanctification, which is the possession of every believer. This positional sanctification is the possession of every New Testament believer in Christ. That you have already been sanctified. You have already been set apart through the shed blood of Jesus Christ. This is positional sanctification. Will you please turn your Bible with me to Hebrews chapter 10. We are going to do some studies here that will enlighten us, and I pray that the Holy Spirit will quicken that word in our heart. In Hebrews chapter 10, in this passage of scripture, looking into the context, before sharing this truth of sanctification, God is saying to the writer that the Old Testament is a shadow of things to come, in verse 1. He says, they are just a shadow of the things to come, because in verse 3 he says, for then will they not have ceased to be offered, because that the worshippers once purged, they should have had no more conscience of sin. That in verse 3, he said, but in those sacrifices, there is a remembrance again made of sin on every time. In other words, they had to, in the Old Testament, in the Holy List, they had to go to Jerusalem once a year for their sins to be cleansed, to be purged, and for bulls and goats, the blood of bulls and goats to be shed. But I want you to notice verse 3 says, verse 4 says, but it is not possible. It is not possible for what? For the blood of bulls and of goats to take away sins. It is not possible. So, the Old Testament, the law was just a shadow of things to come. That was why they were doing the sacrifice every year. So, every year you have to be conscious of sin all the time. And that is why now, in this passage of scripture, the Bible says it is not possible for all the bulls that they killed, and the Muslims are still doing that today. They were killing goats every year. They are killing bulls every year to pay, to wipe away their sins. But we want to thank God, the God of Christians, because if you look at verse 25, it says, wherefore, when he came into the world, this is when Jesus was about to go for his assignment. Jesus came to this world as for an assignment. He came to fulfill the purpose of God, to redeem mankind through his shed blood, to bring us out of sin into his marvelous light, to bring us out of the world into God's marvelous light. He delivered us from the power of darkness, and he translated us into the kingdom of his dear son. Now I want you to notice verse 5. Jesus is saying in the word of God that when God was about to send Jesus into the world, when he was about to send Jesus into the world, look at verse 5, he said, wherefore, when he came coming into the world, when Jesus came into the world, he said, sacrifice and offering thou wouldest not, but a body thou hast prepared for me. God had to prepare a body. That was why Jesus came in the womb of a virgin. He had to be prepared. Jesus is God. Before he came, he's God. He was God and he's still God in the flesh, and he's still God where he is right now, because he's the God that is the one that became flesh. So when he was coming, he said, prepare me a body. Give me a body, because God is tired of using goats and bulls every year, shedding the blood of bulls and goats every year. I am going to be the one that's going to be the perfect sacrifice. I am the one that's going to be the one that will shed my blood, and my blood that I will shed, that will be the one that will take away the sin of the world once and for all. Watch this. In verse 5, he said, wherefore, when he come into the world, he said, a sacrifice and offering thou wouldest not, but a body thou prepare for me. In burnt offering and sacrifice for sin, thou hast no pleasure. God will not have no pleasure in all those yearly sacrifices to take away our sin. But in verse 7, he said, then said, hi, lo, I come. In the volume of the book, it is written of me, O Lord. Listen, Jesus had been reading all the Old Testament prophecy. He knew that the prophecy was of him, for him to fulfill destiny, to fulfill prophecy. So he said, you have prepared a body for me, because when I go into the world, you have already, it has been written of me to go and do your will, O Lord. What was that will? The will to go and lay down his life to die for the sins of the whole world. But he had to have a body in order to shed, because the life of the flesh is in the blood, and it is the blood that makes atonement for the soul. So he had to have a physical body in order for him to be able to shed that blood for us once and for all. Look at verse 8. He says, above, when he says sacrifice and offering and burnt offering and offering for sin, thou would not, neither at pleasure therein, which are offered by the law. Verse 9 says, then said he, lo, I come to do thy will, O God. He take away the first, that means he's taking away the Old Testament, he's taking away the law, that he may establish the second. What is the second? By the which? Verse 10 says, by the which will we have sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ, once and what? For all. So, positionally, you are sanctified. The man in the inside is holy. Sanctification means setting apart, to be separated. They call them saints. That's why the Bible calls us, we are the saints. See, sometimes you think, you feel like you are not a saint. The day you are born again, you are a saint. You are holy. You are righteous, justified, and you have been sanctified positionally. Amen. It is an attainment. This position of sanctification is an attainment. It is the state into which God in grace calls sinful men, and in which they begin their course as a Christian. In Hebrews chapter 3, verse 1, it says, holy brethren, partakers of heavenly calling. God is calling you holy brethren. Partakers of heavenly calling. You have been called out of darkness. You have been called out of the world. And God now is saying, you are holy. You are the holy brethren. You are the partakers of heavenly calling. In the Old Testament, God called out the nation of Israel to become holy unto him. Out of the whole world, the nation of Israel was the only one that had a covenant with God. All the rest of the world had no covenant. Now, through the blood and shed blood of Jesus Christ, those who come to God through him, now we are having a covenant with our God. We are the called out one. born, we were called out from the world into the glorious kingdom of His grace. Amen. So now we have been made holy. That is why in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9, the Bible says, "You are a chosen generation. You are a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people." That means God has called you holy. He has called you peculiar. It means you are special to me because I called you out. He said, "So that you may show forth His praise." He called us out to come and worship. He called us out to come and have a relationship. He called us out so that He can be a father to us and we children to Him, so that we can come back to the original plan that He created mankind for. Amen? Are you with me? Now, the second aspect of sanctification. The second aspect of sanctification is experiential. Are you with me? The second aspect of sanctification is progressive or experiential sanctification. In the text in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 25, 23, we say God's desire is to separate us, set us apart, make us whole, spirit, soul, and what? And body. Amen? And we have established the fact that your true person, your true, the inward man, not the outward man, the one that is going to heaven, the one that God sees you, has been made perfect, has been made holy, has been made righteous, has been justified, qualified, and sanctified positionally. But God's desire is that what has been made a reality inside of us must be made manifest for the world to see. When we say we are Christian, God says that I'm going to manifest, notice, this progressive kind or aspect of sanctification is the holiness of one's the believers. Is the way we are allowing what has been made a reality inside of us to be made manifest into the natural through our flesh. That you that people used to see as a bad person, you that people used to look down on, why do you have a testimony? Why do you look at yourself and say, "Thank God, I'm not where I'm supposed to be, but I'm not who you are used to be"? Why do you have a testimony? Why do people now see you and say, "Wow, do you see that sister that used to in his little, he will have had you and force and fight with you? Now that sister is not the way it used to be more. Don't you notice something inside of sister so-so-so or brother so-so-so, my co-worker? It's not quiet now. There's a spirit of gentleness all over her." You see, because something has been made a reality inside of you. God has separated you and He has set you apart, make you holy. That holiness, because of your stepping out in faith into the Bible studies, into church, in your personal relationship and studying of the Word, and those things beginning to come out. That holiness is not going to be made by you, because we don't want to go back to the law again or to the work of your righteousness. You are not going to be the one that is going to manifest that holiness. Because I've had many preachers, I've had many ministers, they will go to people who are unsaved, who are still in the world, who are prostitutes, who are drug addicts, who are still doing all the wonderful things, and they will tell them, "Hey, this is the good news, Jesus loves you, and Jesus wants to bring you into the kingdom, He wants to turn your right around," which is true, but as soon as they put their heart, as soon as they accept and they take Jesus as their Lord and Savior, you know what happened? The next moment, in that same moment, they will start telling the person, "You can't sin no more. You can't curse no more. You can't do this, you can't." Then it will look like, "I'm as well as where I've been, because you told me with the good news that Jesus said, come just like you are. Then all of a sudden I gave my life to Jesus, and then now you are saying, I have to do this, I have to do that. You begin to give me rules and regulations, and they become frustrated and they go back to the world. This aspect of sanctification, progressive, is only by the Holy Ghost. The agent is the Holy Ghost. The whole agent is the Word of God. It is the holiness of one's life, separation of the believer from every evil things and ways, and it must be learned from God through His Word. Turn your Bible with me to John 17. Let us look at John chapter 17. Because it is dangerous to give an unbeliever a good news of what Jesus has done. It is dangerous to win soul into the kingdom, and then the moment you are bringing this soul, the moment you said, okay, Jesus loves you, now you are giving them the law. You are not telling them that they have to perform. You brought them in by grace. Now you want them to continue by the law. Is there anybody with me now? You brought them in by grace, but you want them to continue by the law. You say God is good. He's not judging you. He loves you. He wants to do great things for you. And the moment they receive Jesus, then you say, okay, you have to live by the law now. You have to stop this. You have to stop that. You didn't give them the opportunity. It's like you have a baby. You're praying for a baby. Lord, grant me a baby that will be a doctor, that will be a lawyer, and I know you will give me this baby. And as soon as you got pregnant, you praise the Lord and worship. And as soon as you have that baby, you say, okay, now baby, you must be a lawyer, you must be a teacher, you must be this, you must be that. And then baby say, man, I'm gonna stay where I was. No, I'm telling you, you brought me here, now you are trying to frustrate me, you are telling me to become what I cannot. It is impossible for you to live a Christian life without the Holy Ghost. I say it again, it is impossible for you to live a Christian life or to bear the fruit of holiness without the Holy Ghost or without the Word of God. We must be able to teach people to know that this progressive sanctification is, the Bible says, I mean, is as a progressive. Progressive means it's from glory to glory, from one state to the other. You must be a baby first, drink a meal, and growing from stage 1 to stage 2 to stage 5 to stage 10. So we must understand, look at John 17, please. Let us read John 17 together. In John chapter 17, let us start from verse 16. This is Jesus praying for the church. He's praying for the Christian. And in verse 16, it says, they are not of the world. Now, we are not of the world. If you are there, please shout amen.
Amen.
John chapter 17, verse 16, it says, we are not of the world, even as what? As I am not of the world. Is that what it says? He says, they were not of the world, even as I am not of the world. Look at verse 17. Verse 17 says, sanctify, separate them. Sanctify them through that what? Truth. That word is what? Truth. So the only way you can be set apart, the only way you can be a fruit, the only way you can walk in holiness, the only way this progressive sanctification can become manifest in your manifested in your life is through the Word of God. So look at verse 18. It says, as thou hast sent me, this is Jesus praying here. He says, as thou hast sent me into the world, even so have I also sent them into the world. Into the world. And for their sake, look at verse 19. I want you to watch that and catch this. He says, and for their sake, that means for our sake, I sanctify myself. That means I separated myself. For our sake, he says, and for their sake, I sanctify myself, that they also might be sanctified through thy truth. Do you see that? Until we receive the revelation, watch this, watch this. Let me show you this. what Jesus is saying. Jesus said, when God was going to send me into the world to go and fulfill purpose, to go and fulfill the assignment, he said, I have to go and sanctify myself, set myself apart, because I have an assignment, I have a mission, I have a fourth purpose to fulfill the destiny and to fulfill the purpose of God. So, because of us, the Bible says Jesus separated himself for our sake. So he said, and then he said something, he said, just like he came and God sent him, he is sending us too. To be separated, why? So that we can fulfill destiny. The purpose for which God has created you. The reason why you are in this world. God said, in order for you to fulfill that destiny, you must also be separated from the world. Because Jesus said, I'm not praying for the world. Why? Because I already died for the world. The world now needs to come out and come and receive the gift of righteousness. So, in this place, he said, you separate yourself. I want to read this passage of scripture from the Amplified Bible. In my Amplified, it says, they are not of the world, worldly, belonging to the world, just as I am not of the world. Verse 17, sanctify them, purify, consecrate, separate them for yourself. Make them holy by the truth. Your word is truth. Just as you sent me into the world, I also sent them into the world. And so for their sake, and on their behalf, I sanctify, dedicate, consecrate myself, that they also may be sanctified, dedicated, consecrated, made holy in the truth. What God is saying is that it is the word of God that will cause you to bear fruits. You cannot bear fruit of holiness by yourself. Anytime you are trying to bear the fruit of holiness by yourself, you are back into the law and you will frustrate yourself. You allow the enemy to condemn you. You will say, man, every time. Have you noticed every time you want to stop something, you fast, you pray, you do everything, and still, you know, nothing change. Because you're trying to do it without God. There's nothing, you cannot do anything. Or, like I said earlier, it is impossible to live a Christian life without the Holy Spirit. The agent of sanctification is the Holy Ghost. It's the Holy Spirit that will take the Word of God that you have studied, you have meditated upon, that the Holy Spirit will take it and it will work it out to be a foot in your life. That is why Jesus said, I am the vine. You are the branches. You see, he said you cannot bear fruit on your own unless you abide in the vine. You cannot see a branch bearing fruit on itself just on the ground. The branches must be attached to the vine. In order for you to see the branch bearing fruit, it must stay in the vine. And the vine is receiving the source of life and is releasing nutrition and everything, nutrition to the branches to bear fruits. So Jesus said, I am the vine. You are the branches. You can do nothing without me. Without the word, without your relationship with the Lord, you cannot bear fruit. If you bear fruit, it's just a fake one, religious fruit. You become legalistic. Anytime you condemn people, look at you. You judge people. You are good to judge. Because you feel like you are holding them down. You are better than somebody else. I'm doing this, I'm doing that. And you look down on people that do not do that and you begin to judge them. But when the Holy Spirit is the one working in you, you have no boast of yourself. You can't say, I stop this, I stop that. You are thankful to God that, oh Lord, I look at my past and I say, Father, I thank you that you are progressively transforming me, and you are transforming me from glory to glory, that yes, I'm still going. I'm still running the race. Even though I'm not where I'm supposed to be, I am not where I used to be. Father, I praise you that I'm in your house today. That if anything happened, bless the Lord for the victim of 9/11. I know where I will be. that I will be right in the presence of the Most High God. Amen? You won't have no fear because you are in church. You have a relationship with God. Not because of your perfection, but because of His grace. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. I say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
It is very, very important to understand what the scripture is saying. You cannot change yourself, but there is something that God has commanded to come out of the world. Listen, you can't be driving your vehicle and saying, I don't know, this thing is going on in my car, this and that and that, and then you call the mechanic and tell them, this is what's going on, I don't know why. The first thing the mechanic will tell you, bring your car. I can't fix your car while you're still driving it. God is saying that sometimes we have to come out from the world. We have to come out from running around, and then we have to be separate. To be separated is to set ourselves apart. Turn with me to Romans chapter 12. Turn with me to Romans chapter 12 and look at what God is advising or and encouraging us. How to fulfill destiny. Romans chapter 12. This is God through His servant begging, appealing, asking us, and beseeching us. He says in Romans chapter 12, if you're there, say amen with me.
Amen.
Hallelujah. In Romans chapter 12, this is a powerful teaching that if we grasp the revelation, your life will never remain the same again, and you will never allow yourself to be condemned. You will not worry about where somebody else has the success of another person. The reason why you're not going to worry about the success or the progress of another person, because as long as you are in the Lord, you will rejoice with that person. You know God is working in your own life too. Amen?
Amen.
You will rejoice with that person. Say, well, I'm thankful for that sister, for that brother who is growing in grace. Because you know that God is going to, your season is coming too. God is working in your life too. As long as you're having a relationship with God. In that book of Romans chapter 12, in from verse 1, here Paul is writing. He said, I'm beseeching you. I'm begging you. He said, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your work, your body as a living sacrifice. See, this is not a great topic in the church. Many of us do not want to hear that, but for us to be sanctified by the truth, whether we like it or not, we must preach the whole full counsel of God. Because that is what's going to help us. So Paul is saying, I'm begging you, brethren, sisters, that we present our body a living sacrifice. That means you have to you have to make a sacrifice. When your car breaks down, you have to make that sacrifice of letting it go to the mechanic and wait for some time so that they can fix it, so that they can ride it good. The same likewise is once you, the only way you can have time to study, you have to sacrifice some things. That's what God is saying. God is not saying for you to produce the fruit, but He's saying for you to set yourself apart where you have time. You cannot leave the world, run the world, and at the same time have time to sow the seed that will produce fruits in your life. That's what God is saying, because I want to help us to understand there are so many people who use that scripture. Oh, do not conform to this world, amen. Present your body a living sacrifice, holy. You got to be holy, you got to be this, you got to do this. No. What He's saying is that, get away. What the reason why God is telling us to come out from the world is so that we can have time to fellowship with Him. Time to study His word. You cannot live in the world and live in the world at the same time. But while you are separating yourself, now I want you to understand, it's not saying to not talk to any unbelievers. We're going to get there. But what God is saying is that when you separate yourself, when you sacrifice, Some things that you are doing in the world that is taking your time in fellowship, in going to church. There's a lot of people that are supposed to be in church today on Sunday, but they were in their house. They were doing what they want to do. Some of them are not even at home sleeping and resting. They are in the car wash shining their wheel on Sunday. They are shining their wheel. And I see that wheel is going to take them to heaven. So we see a lot of stuff that these people, they were doing. And God is saying, why can't you sacrifice? Especially holy day. Do you know that holy day is the day of the Lord? Why can't you just sacrifice that this day I'm going to give all the honor and glory to my God because he has given me strength, grace to be at work for the 5-6 days of the week. He has given me the strength and grace to be able to sleep well for 6 days. But this 7th day, I'm going to give him adoration. I'm going to thank him because today is the beginning of another week. And I want to start the beginning of another week with God Almighty. That's what God is saying. It's commitment. It's sacrifice. Listen, there are so many people who want to go to heaven, but they want to die. You got to die before you get to heaven. What am I talking about? What I'm saying is that if you are going to experience the abundance of the kingdom, if you are going to experience the abundant life that Jesus came to give, you have to die to the world and be alive in the kingdom. Sometimes we don't even listen. When I was a crook, when I was in the world, nobody can tell me anything about Christianity. I thought it was Paul. See, me coming to church, do I look like somebody who used to be in church? Don't call me to come to church because I thought they were missing a lot of fun. I thought they were missing it. How can you miss this beer? How can you miss this cigarette? How can you miss this weed? How can you miss this club? No, no, that I was the one missing. Because I don't have to smoke in order to enjoy my life. I don't have to get drunk before I enjoy life. It's just the deception of the outward man. That is why when you make a sacrifice to come into the kingdom and you start reading, you become bored. You know who is bored? I remember when I first met my wife, I used to say, man, I can't do nothing. Yeah, go church, Bible study. And I basically get to her and say, you know what's going to get a man? The flesh is getting mad. Because flesh wants to go and kick me and jam and start and be cool and say, you know. So the flesh is not having its way and you're getting bored. My first 6 months of studying the Bible was like hell. Because no, it wasn't fun. It wasn't fun to start something that you have not been doing before. It wasn't fun. But after you break through, the first 6 months of my cigarette smoking too, it wasn't fun because the first time, how can you be smoking, you're coughing and you're still smoking, you're still coughing. That's sickness. You know this thing is making you cough and making you get, and you still keep on buying it. Some people have a big old cough or sickness, and you still say, give me a cigarette. You know, this is demonic. So, but after 6 months, when I started, even though with all my coughing, I kept on smoking, you know, after 6 months, I don't only even take it out of my mouth, I started taking it out of my nose. Now, I'm professional now. You know, the body got used to it, and it was hard for me to stop. Because the moment you stop, what you have used in your body, what you have been enjoying in your body, the moment you stop, you'll be like, the whole world has collapsed around you. Man, how can I drink no more? That's why you see the drug people, you're sinning. When they don't do it, you can tell, they just start sinning. You know, they say, just like a man. Like, they are not stable. You say, man, are you alright? Are you alright? Because they want it, they're looking for it. Yes. They are looking for it. You will see, you will notice quickly. Now, what God is saying is that if you want to see the abundance of life, if you want to enjoy it, so many times I used to hear preachers say, the Lord said to me, spoke to me, and says, What is lie? How can God speak to you? But because I was a baby there. But now I can see God speaking. The Bible says God speaks through his word. God speaks to your spirit. You can hear the voice of God in your spirit. Because he is a spirit. Those that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. When you are not matured in the things of God, you cannot hear from God. But God does speak. But the reason why we are not enjoying the blessing of the kingdom is because we are still, one foot is in the world. You know, we can't enjoy it like that. There is a sacrifice that we have to make. That sacrifice. Look at what it said in that Romans 12. He said, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercy of God, that you present your body a living sacrifice, only acceptable unto the Lord. Because this is your what? Reasonable service. It's reasonable. Look at what God did for you. God paid the price. Jesus said, I sanctify myself. I set apart myself so that you may be able to set yourself apart and fulfill destiny too. And this is why he said you should set yourself apart. Look at the reason why he said set yourself apart. Verse 2. He said, the reason why I'm saying to get away from the world so that you can be able to study. He said, in verse 2, what did he say? He said, do not be what? Conformed into this world. But be ye transformed. By what? By the renewing of your mind. Because if you are in the world, you won't have no time to renew your mind. And if you are not renewing your mind, you are not going to be transformed. There is no shortcut. The blessing that we Christians have is because of the renewal of our mind. Look at what it says in the last verse. It says, so that you may know what? That you may prove. Oh, glory. Is that what it says? He said, "You may, so that when you are renewing your mind, you will be able to prove what is good, what is acceptable, and what is the perfect will of God for you. Do you want to know the perfect will of God? Do you not want to know what is acceptable? Do you want to know what is good for you?" He said, "The only way you can taste and see that the Lord is good is you have to be in the kingdom." People criticize preachers. Oh, helicopter, oh, this, all that. Because they are enjoying the blessing of the kingdom. They are having revelation. One person see me long. I mean, it was some long time ago. He said, wow, you are driving the Mercedes-Benz now? Wow, you don't have car before. A long time ago, 15 years ago. I said, that was 15 years ago. I'm a Christian now. I'm a servant of the Most High God. Hey, you are a pastor too? Ah, man, I need to go and be a pastor. Yeah. You are a pastor? Because they look at you the way they were. You used to be. But they didn't know that the word of God can change man's heart. There's a transformation. Jesus said, when you abide in me, my word abide in you, you will ask whatsoever you will, and it shall be done for you. He said that because of the fruit, because of your word inside of you, my word inside of you, he said you will bear good fruits. And he said, much fruits. He said, so that my Father may be glorified, and your joy may be full. You cannot taste the goodness of God unless you enter. Let me tell you something. You can't tell me about how heaven is operating if you have not been in heaven. You got to be in heaven and see heaven alive. Then you can come and tell me. So many people, when I was a drug person, a drug addict and everything, I didn't know what that's for in church. If I should be in church, I would be bored. You must be glad to help me to come one time, and the next time I'm hiding from you. I didn't want you to see me. On Saturday, I have to tell you, don't come to my house today because I have to go somewhere. I'll be somewhere, and because I don't want you to call me to come to church. Because the spirit is desiring to go to the house of God, but your flesh says, man, I don't want to. But you have to make a sacrifice. You have to continue to pay the price. You have to allow yourself to say, there's only way, and one way is Jesus Christ, the word of the living God, that my life can be changed. Amen? Amen. Because throughout the whole Bible, New Testament, God has been warning us. In 1 John chapter 2, verse 15 to 17. The Bible says, do not love the world. Is that not what the Bible says in 1 John chapter 2? In 1 John chapter 2, because of time, I will go right quick and just quote it. He said, do not love the world. Verse 15. He said, nor the things that is in the world. He said, because those things that are in the world, they are the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, they are the pride of life. It is not of the Father, it is of the world. He said, and the world is what? Passing away. But the word of the living God lasts forever. Do you know what will last forever in your life? Do you know what is God going to look in your life? It's not about any achievement you have made here on the earth. God is not looking about the mansion, about all your credentials, about your fame and power. God is not recording that. That is your enjoyment when you are in this world. What God is looking at is what's going to remain. What is going to remain? Everything will be burned away. Your flesh that is enjoying, that is having all that thing, they go to the dust. The only thing that God will look, when they want to, some of us, when they open your own book, some people's book about what they have done will have been full up like this. But some people, they can only get a piece of paper because there's nothing, that all the rest are worldly stuff that's going to burn away. So what God is saying is that seek first the kingdom. He says, don't store up treasure on heart. Where moth will come. He said, store up your treasure in heaven. Let it be about the kingdom. About how you are running your race. About the assignment that God has given you. About how you are touching lives. How you are praying for people. How you are giving to people. To the poor. How you are helping the widow. How you are helping people in your workplace. How you are telling them about the Lord. It is about the things of the Spirit. Yes, God wants us to enjoy our life while we are still in the physical, because we don't want to be too much spiritual that we are useless in the physical. But we still have to enjoy. We still have to go somewhere. Even when you want to go to Paris. Now, I want you to understand this. I'm not teaching about don't go to party, don't do this, don't do that. Hey, God is going to walk with you. He's going to walk in you till you get to that separation. But what I'm saying is that there are some things that we have to let go to cut down so that we can have time with God. God is not telling you not watch TV. But there are some things we have to let go and don't watch because it's not good to our spirit. Well, God, Jesus went to the marriage and turned water into wine. So I'm not being too religious here. I'm not saying don't do this, don't do that. But I'm saying that try to separate. When God is telling you to come out of the world, he's not saying that don't look down on the unbelievers. Because you're still going to have family unbelievers. You're still going to have co-workers unbelievers. What God is saying is that when you are, you say, abstain from every appearance of evil. That means when you see what the unbelievers are doing, remove yourself from them because they can implicate you. Or when you see them doing something or going somewhere, you say, I'm not going there because I would love to go, because if I do go, I can't condemn myself because I know I